Welcome to the art studio of E. Sherman Hayman.
I'm a sucker for art and I'm a sucker for stories. And I met an artist who combines these two in glorious ways. Get a load of this. Ars Moriendi, the final frontier.
Here's the thing about death. Death is the new sex. In the 1800s, people did not talk about sex except in euphemisms. But death was an everyday occurrence. When someone was dying, you didn't say, they're passing. You're saying, they're dying. They died. They're dead. But they did it at home. People would come to visit. There were books called Ars Moriendi, The Art of Dying, written in the 1600s, I believe, during the Black Plague, which were almost like etiquette books that told people, the dying people had certain protocols that they would follow. They would greet people from the bed if they were able. They would dispense advice. They would dispense blessings. The books also explain what to do if you were visiting the dying person. Now we're in the 21st century. Nobody talks about death. Everybody talks about sex. And you can be sitting on a bus and someone will be on their cell phone discussing the most intimate details of their sex lives. But we don't say someone died. We say they passed on, yes. We're afraid of it. I'm afraid of it. So this whole series about death, the final frontier, I knew I wanted to do something, but I also knew I had to approach it sideways. So I thought I'll do it in a humorous way. And I figured out how to carve wood. And I made these little caskets, and each one commemorates a certain person, an artist or somebody that I found had an interesting life and had a visual life, like Coco Chanel. She got into trouble during World War II because she was living at the Ritz with a Nazi officer. So when the war ended, she was in disgrace. She moved to Switzerland for a few years, but eventually moved back, and the house of Chanel thrived. She had an amazing career as a couturier. The little Nazi emblem on the belt is the giveaway, and I tried to put a lot of detail into it, like the coffin handles that the pallbearers would use. In this case, they're the intertwined C's, which was actually her logo. This one, for instance, is Le Corbusier, who was famous for building on little piloti, I think, pylons, and usually a lot of white, very modular motifs. This was John Montagu, Earl of Sandwich, who actually invented the sandwich. This one is Roy Lichtenstein, and it has a great quote that I had read from him years ago. So, you profess to be anti-contemplative, anti-nuance, anti-movement, and light? During an interview, and I don't remember his answer, but I bet it was a good one. This little one with all the little tiny shrubbery is André Le Nôtre, who was a French landscape architect and did, I think he did Versailles, and he was the first one, I think, to treat gardening as an art. Mm-hmm. another of my little favorites. This is the casket in commemoration of Julia Child, who was American but French in spirit, and it's sort of like a cherry tart. And of course the casket handles in her case are a little, a knife, a fork, and a spoon.
Oh boy.
And Fred Astaire, of course. First one, and this was very political. This is the casket of the unknown soldier. So if you look inside, you see the stars, see a little peace sign, and on the cover, you see the gas tank.
Oh, yes.
It's about our oil dependence. This one is Isadora Duncan. She was a pretty amazing person. She was a dancer. She reinvented herself many times. She was in a Ducati in, I believe, the 1920s, and her scarf flew back and wound around the wheel of the car, and she strangled herself to death.
That looks like a bottle, right?
It does.
It is a bottle.
It is a bottle. And it's Jackson Pollock.
From drinking?
Yep, he died, I believe, in a car accident. He was drunk. This one, I love this one. Frank Lloyd Wright, the architect. So his whole casket is kind of cantilevered, like his buildings.
Wow.
Caress Crosby. She's somebody who in the early, I guess it was maybe 1915 or 16, she was a society girl with a different name, and she had bought a new dress, and her boobs were showing through, and she was embarrassed, so her maid concocted something out of silk handkerchiefs that became a brassiere.
That's the first brassiere?
It was the first brassiere, but if I remember correctly, she never got it patented. But she ended up moving to Paris. She was a co-publisher of, I think it was called the Black Sun Press. She moved in artistic circles, and she actually lived to a ripe old age.
And there it is, the first bra.
Right.
Wow.
This one is Mata Hari. To this day, there's a question whether she spied for the Germans or spied for the French. She was executed, I believe, by the French for being a German spy. But before she got to that point, she had traveled the world. She had lived in Indonesia, which is why there's some Indonesian patterning. She was an exotic dancer. She was a high-end prostitute. She always wore a sequin bra, and she used to tell her lovers she could never take it off because a former lover had bitten her breast off. But in reality, during this period of time, women were in general more buxom, and she was very, very flat-chested.
Oh, so it wasn't a secret recording device. It was just embarrassment.
It was embarrassment that she invented this whole story about.
How do you pick people to build caskets for?
I think I needed somebody whose life intrigued me, but there had to be more visuals to their life. And artists were easy, like Picasso. When I did Picasso, I just sort of worked with his palette, and I combined some of the classical elements for the casket handles, the collaged elements, the harlequin pattern, the dove.
Hellcat Maggie. They say she wore a string of ears in a necklace. I carved each of those ears.